Okay. Thank you all for what is about to be a very long presentation. So Anthony and I ran some numbers, and to our best guess, The Last of Us Part 2 is 10 to 30% longer than The Last of Us Part 1. However, this is the most detailed story presentation we've ever done. Like, if you think about the presentation for T1, where we kind of talk about the quarantine zone in somewhat detail, even though most of it changed. And then it's like, and here are some things that might happen with Joel and Ellie. They might go into a spore-filled subway tunnel. They might fight some cannibals. At some point, Joel will get incapacitated. And Ellie, this has everything figured out, even though it might change. Every character is accounted for. Every cinematic is accounted for in this presentation, which means it's going to feel twice as long as the first game. So when you freak out, that's normal. That's part of this. Oh, this is about an hour and a half to 2 hours, so hopefully you got your pee break. Okay, so we open on 15-year-old Ellie. This is a few weeks after the events of the first game. There's a doorway leading down to this basement. And Ellie sees Tommy, and he's just finished climbing out of this basement, and he's hurt bad, and he's rambling about something, needed to go after these people. Ellie's trying to ask him, what happened? Where's Joel? And he doesn't make any sense to her, and she starts to go downstairs. Tommy grabs her hand and tries to stop her, but he's too weak. She rips her arm away, and she heads down. And with each step, her heart races faster and faster as she sees this trail of blood. She opens the door, revealing Joel's mutilated body. And then shock just sets in, and she screams and tries to grab his body, and Dina comes and rips her away, and on that cacophony of sounds, silence. Oh, we're just getting started.
I've been working on this game since we finished. Well, really, been thinking about it since we finished The Last of Us.
So many people were like, Last of Us 1 is so perfect. It should never have a sequel. They shouldn't make a sequel.
They're like, oh, it wrapped up super great. But I think actually, if you look at the ending.
Swear to me that everything that you've said about the Fireflies is true.
Ellie is accepting a lie.
I swear.
Okay. She has a very good bullshit detector. She knows something doesn't feel right, but I think is too scared at that point to ask.
How long can you really live with accepting a lie like that?
The Last of Us feels like an origin story for the survivor in this post-apocalyptic world. Seeing like how Ellie has become such a strong, unique character. It really felt like, you know, if we were to do a sequel, it'd be a shame for it not to focus on her.
Move the fuck out of the way.
Yeah, once we're done with this whole thing, I'm gonna teach you how to play guitar.
Yeah, I reckon you'd really like that.
What do you say, huh?
Joel, he's gonna teach Ellie to play guitar. That always felt like that's just this, like, unanswered promise that, like, was kind of lingering at the end of the first game. We did this thing called One Night Live, where we had the actors come on stage and reenact certain scenes.
So you say we get you to the Fireflies. What happens next?
Marlene, she said that they have their own little quarantine zone and that doctors are still trying to find a cure.
I wrote this new scene that takes place after the ending of The Last of Us, but it was only shown to people in the audience. Like, we cut off the stream right before we showed them the scene.
If I ever were to lose you, I'd surely lose myself. Try and sometimes you'll succeed to make this man of me. Our future days, days of you and me.
She's yours.
No, I don't know the first thing about this.
Hey, I promised you I'd teach you how to play.
That scene ends with Ellie holding the guitar and playing one note. And that image was so strong in my mind that I'm sure that kind of trickled into this idea of this trailer. So I started working on some concept art, kept fleshing out the story. And as it felt like it was kind of gaining momentum, Uncharted 4 needed all hands on deck.
Naughty Dog had always made one game, and as soon as it finishes one game, it works on another. When I started on Uncharted 3, we were starting to experiment then with trying to do two teams. After we finished Uncharted 3, I jumped onto Uncharted 4. At some point in time, Uncharted 4 was coming down to the wire, and it's just, we had to shift resources, and pretty much everyone just ended up on Uncharted, trying to finish it up.
So I said, okay, before I come on like in full force on Uncharted 4, I just want to capture this trailer.
Beside the still waters, and they restore my soul, but I can't walk on the path of the right, because I'm wrong.
During the entire production of Uncharted 4, that's all I could think about. I had a lot of investment in Uncharted 4, but the day we were done with Uncharted 4, went right back to that trailer to wrap it up. Anything for this shot that's still happening?
Not in animation.
Of the shadow of death.
This one feels kind of strong to me. Drawing a lot of attention. Can we tone that down?
Yep.
Actually, my biggest fear with this announcement is that it leaks early. More than anything, I have nightmares about this trailer leaking early before we get to PSX. If we're gonna surprise people, PSX, the PlayStation experience, hasn't set itself up yet as a place where big titles get revealed. That's E3. Revealing the Uncharted single-player content at the opening of the show.
You're late. I thought you were professional.
Oh, you should relax. You'll live longer.
No one's going to expect a second Naughty Dog title to be revealed in the same press conference.
Please welcome to the stage Sean Layden.
There's one more special unveil we have for you tonight. Please enjoy it.
When we first revealed The Last of Us, the Naughty Dog logo came up and the crowd erupted, and it was such a high that that's almost been like chasing the dragon, like wanting to recapture that feeling.
Oh my God. Why does this look like The Last of Us, dude? Yeah.
Playing it at this surprising moment, I'm hopeful it will have a similar feel.
Thank you.
What are you doing, kiddo?
People outside the studio have such an attachment to the first game, and I've definitely seen fears about not wanting to make a sequel because somehow if it's bad, it will tarnish your feeling about the first game.
I'm gonna find, and I'm gonna kill every last one of them.
We're doubling down on those fears and not calling it The Last of Us some subtitle. It's The Last of Us Part Two to say it's all one story. The concept for the sequel had to feel compelling enough, have enough weight that felt like, okay, this is an experience worth creating, worth spending the next 3 years on. I became really intrigued with the idea of the cycle of violence and how, like, certain events would trigger acts of violence that then would beget more acts of violence.
It's almost never satisfying. It never brings the person you love back. And despite you thinking it's gonna bring some closure, it doesn't.
We just need more empathy. Wouldn't it be awesome if we could create an experience that lets you safely explore those feelings? With that theme, all of a sudden everything fell into place and this outline emerged. The whole catalyst for what starts the second game is Joel killing the doctor. That feeds right back in that idea of that cycle of violence. Now it sets up this whole kind of sequence of events. We're gonna start the game where you're playing a new character. That sequence ends with this character killing Joel. And we really have to paint her as this monster. Then when you play the next chunk of the game and you're Ellie and you're gonna pursue justice, quote unquote, and you're gonna go kill this entire crew, we're gonna go back in time and show you that same sequence of events, this character that you saw as a monster, to now get you to see things from her perspective. And how this crew is a bunch of people trying to survive in this world, and they have their reasons for pursuing and finding Joel and killing him. And the story was becoming very epic and ambitious, and I had a few parts that I was kind of stuck on, and I felt like to kind of shake things up, I wanted to bring in another writer.
I thought it was a very thoughtful story about violence and obsession. He had Abby, sort of like this girl who was the daughter of the doctor. And that Ellie would go on this vengeance quest. And when he was like, and then Ellie actually kills Abby, I was like, what? No, you're enough. Yeah, let's fucking do it.
Not only is she contributing in a lot of ways, I feel like she's challenging what this story can be. She's wanted to add more romantic intimacy between the characters. Those are areas that I've been, I don't know, more uncomfortable writing that stuff. After the first day, she was telling me that she went home and told her husband that I think I just got Ellie's girlfriend pregnant, because that was her big idea the first day, and that had this trickle-on effect and actually added a lot to the story.
Ellie is this very relatable character. I thought she was a perfect vehicle to challenge this notion that violence doesn't have a cost, because it does have a cost in reality. It's going to ruin this girl. You know, people love Joel and Ellie, and we are about to kill one and make the other one a villain.
I was very nervous telling Troy we're gonna kill off Joel.
In the first game, he was advocating that Joel should die.
When I read the ending to part one, I was like, you're gonna piss a lot of people off.
Let me go.
Marlene is the closest thing to a parent that Ellie has had outside of Joel.
You just come after her.
A lot of people get hurt, and Marlene would be one of those people.
Joel has crossed these moral lines, and therefore he deserved to die, and he thought it might be a more dramatic ending. And I was like, no, you're crazy. Like, but then in the second game, that's why I was like, thought of like, oh, he would take it pretty easily.
He goes, so Joel dies, and he's like, and so this happens, and then and I literally had to stop. I was like, can you give me just a second? Because it literally was as if someone was telling me about how my friend had just died.
I think he kind of took it hard. It was like the character meant so much to him. We're going to kill off this character. His role is going to be much smaller on this one.
All of a sudden, it was, please don't take this from me yet.
Ellie is scared to be alone. Everybody that she's loved up until that point, she's lost them.
It's hard to imagine the story without Joel dying. Like, you feel that hate, Ellie feels that hate. You're one-to-one, you're on the stick, and that informs the rest of the story.
This way, come on! You okay?
Yeah.
We get you through interactivity to really connect and empathize with this character.
You'll act like you heard of us or something.
And then make you feel like I've led Joel to a trap.
When we started out making Last of Us Part Two, Neil actually wanted to be very ambitious about changing the game almost entirely. In the first like 4 or 5 months, the game was actually in kind of an open world inspired by Bloodborne. And like it was purely melee focused, like it was all hand-to-hand combat.
It wasn't just the melee combat, we were also looking at sort of layout structure. Bloodborne had a very sort of an open space that sort of kept getting bigger and bigger as you explored. I really like that feeling that you get of mastery over the world. It starts to become kind of almost a character in the game itself. And so that was also something we were looking at.
We started out making it as different as humanly possible from the first game as we could, and then kind of dialing it back. The open world thing didn't work with the story that we were trying to tell and stuff.
So in pre-production, we spent a lot of time just doing setups. I've got your back. Self-contained sort of units that tried to expound on a single sort of idea. Trying to start out with sort of simple shapes and building up to more complex shapes and starting out with one or two mechanics and building up to those mechanics.
Huh? Hey! Even our experiments, we try to add like as much context as we can. Like we establish a goal that you're gonna be going for. We establish beats so that there's like an emotional journey, the stakes are raised. Figuring out some traversal stuff. A lot of climbing and balance beams and seeing how far we can sort of push in that direction without it getting over the top like Uncharted.
More sort of verticality. More use of the grass and stealth.
My name is Arnaldo Lisamp.
And what do you do here?
I do design.
How long have you been doing that?
A day. I got an opportunity to work in QA, and that was That was a great learning experience. I shipped The Last of Us and Uncharted 4.
The thing I'm proudest of is the people who came in to a quality assurance job as a contractor, which is entry-level work, and used that job to get to where they ultimately wanted to be.
When I interviewed for the QA position, I specifically said that my goal was to be a designer.
He had formed this relationship with design where they knew they could rely on him, spending his free time designing a demo, and at the same time, him going to them and not being like, here's 50 bugs you need to fix. He went to them and was like, what do you need? How do I help you? What kind of bugs do you need? And for their part, they embraced him and were like, why don't we show you how to lay out NavMesh?
I am anxious to prove myself. There is no babying when you start. It just hits the ground running. If I don't cut it, I go back to QA or find something else. We're trying to figure out at the moment how we handle big spaces, bigger than the first game.
The enemies are so, like, too spread out to be really considered like one single small encounter. And seeing what behaviors we need to start developing for them to make it look good.
The opening of Seattle, that whole section was pretty slow and quite linear in the level design.
Let's assume that there's guys in this building, someone's starting to shoot at me from the second floor. So, okay, if I'm on the horse and I'm getting shot at, I can't take cover with the horse, so I'm probably first thing I'm gonna do is jump off. And that's slow and clumsy, and maybe we can make that faster. It's like, but once I jump off, I'm gonna wanna take cover behind something. It's like, okay, I'm taking cover. Now what the fuck do I do with this horse? I assume the enemies are gonna shoot at it. If they don't, that's kinda weird. Does Dina ride off with the horse to help it stay safe? Well, that sucks, because I'm trying to build a relationship with Dina, and if my partner leaves me, that makes me like her less. I'm like, okay, so Dina has to get off the horse and take cover with me and help me engage with the enemies. Okay, but the horse is still there, so what happens with this horse? Does it ride off on its own in order to like protect itself and then come back after? Oh, that feels too intelligent for a horse. That seems a little funny. As soon as there's range combat, the horse kind of makes it fall apart. What if we did this whole sequence on foot? How do I approach this building? Imagine this is more dense with cars and ferns and interesting ways for me to close this distance. Maybe when I get close enough, two militia guys come out. I have this little firefight with this front before I could rush forward and go into this building, climb up and take out the sharpshooter that was harassing me. Really simple, small fight. Now there's tension. Guys can come from anywhere, like from this rooftop, from these windows.
And that really inspired us to take some pretty drastic changes as far as the flow, inserting more combat, opening up the layout to give the player more options as far as how they explore the city.
You can imagine this as being kind of the hub with it poking into streets, and I could go into the streets and explore and find those locations, what we're kind of calling dungeons. So that's the plan. Some of these changes are big, but it got us excited. This feels like a true evolution of T1 as far as going more systemic and giving you options.
If there's concern, it's about scale, it's about scope, it's about can we actually build this thing?
The scope is always bigger than the last game. It always has been. It always will be, probably. But this scope on this game is something pretty extraordinary.
Everyone seems to agree that the thing we're building is going to be cool once it's done. It's just that it's such a big game.
Our games have become more and more ambitious, and the studio has gotten a lot bigger.
When I started here, we were 40 people. Now we're over 300. You can't handle that many people with a flat hierarchy. As we grew, we've had to introduce new titles just to control management, control communication, make sure things don't fall through the cracks.
We have no producers at Naughty Dog.
There's so many talented people here that you can rely on and lean on. It makes the game better. And that's really kind of the secret sauce of Naughty Dog, is how collaborative it is.
You find the right people who really want to do the best they can possibly do, and then you kind of give them the resources to try. you're getting what you asked for as a creative person, right? You're kind of getting the freedom to go as far as you can go, but sometimes I think we need to be saved from ourselves a little bit.
With The Last of Us 2, there's a real sense of opportunity. This is going to be a much cleaner production than we've done in the past. We're gonna get it right this time.
This is the first project that has had the proper pre-production period where we have locked down, for the most part, the story beginning, middle, and end before we started production. That hasn't happened. I don't know if that has ever happened, now that I think about it.
It's a very, very messy process, which is, again, why it's a lot of times really difficult to schedule. I think right now we are planning on springtime of 2018. So when springtime 2018 comes around, The Last of Us 2 isn't in stores. You can look back at this and say, well, I guess their plan wasn't exactly set in stone.
Historically, we've done very poorly at being efficient without the pressure of an external deadline.
Every time we have some showing of our games, if it's going to be seen publicly, it's got to be one of the best looking playing things in the industry. For example, the first trailer was coming online, and that forced us to define the look of our game, define the location of where the game takes place, define Ellie's look and her age and her hair and her outfit. We're forced to make those choices. We can't just keep iterating because there's a deadline.
We want to try and schedule the game using these milestones as soon as possible.
Which means we gotta keep the marketing rolling, which means next E3, 6 months away, we need to look at a gameplay demo.
E3, it's always been the biggest and most extravagant showing of the game industry. There's something special about the energy of E3.
We need to figure out what the gameplay is, because right now it's just we've got a bunch of like cool prototypes and stuff like that, so it's scary. But we work well under pressure.
We're hoping to be really aggressive and show at E3 2017 just to really kick the project into gear as fast as humanly possible.
We want to break it up into a roughly 2-minute cinematic, a flashback sequence that will set kind of emotional context for what will then go into a 5-minute gameplay sequence. We want to do this festival within Jackson. Like, there'll be like a live band, and we're just seeing people lively having fun.
And for the crowd, are you thinking 30 plus people?
Frank says we could do a 30 variation. I think we can make that work with 30.
Yeah.
Dina pulls Ellie onto the dance floor. Ellie's dancing with her, is making all these guys jealous, and then Dina says, "You want to make them really jealous?" And she leans over and kisses her. And on that, we do a hard cut to Ellie in the middle of the woods. So the idea is we shouldn't see any buildings, just woods, water, ankle-deep water rushing underneath her.
What about rain? Are we still doing rain?
I haven't discussed it with the other guys, but...
That demo that we show externally for the very first time is setting the bar for the rest of development. But the problem is we're also working on Uncharted 4 Lost Legacy.
So E3 is June 13th, which means probably we want to be done, what, like 2 weeks before that, which is 4.5 months from now.
With Lost Legacy shipping at around the same time of E3, there are shared resources between the two projects.
Especially sound and particle effects, so they were all on Uncharted.
And when we come to the polish phase, both we're polishing this and that same, and SPD also, yeah, at the same time. I don't know if there's any specific item that needs to be worked on, but I think there's gonna be programmer time doing both those things.
There are gonna be times when we're, it's like, this needs polishing in E3 and this needs polishing in SBDLC, and like we're gonna have to compromise at times, maybe.
We kind of just didn't have it at the forefront of our minds that, yeah, they're frickin' shipping a video game. It's literally the hardest part of making the game is shipping it. And we were trying to ship a demo, the second hardest thing you can do, at the same time and sharing a lot of their resources.
So one thing would be helpful is to find out what are the items that you feel like you're most worried about. Like, let's say rain. We could do this thing without rain. So if that helps you a ton, we can make the decision not to remove rain.
It would definitely help.
How about wet hair?
Well, if she's going to swimming, then we can get around that, right?
How about no swimming?
Puts on a cap.
I got like a really clear energy of the meeting, which was how do we shrink it?
It was such an impossible task. You can't help but start feeling some doubt, some anxiety about the leadership, not understanding the logic of it. You know, I think like anybody else here, I was definitely ready to roll up my sleeves and figure it out.
All right, guys, we're gonna try to keep this pretty short. So after yesterday's meeting, there were a lot of side conversations and there was sort of a sentiment about how much work there was to get not only this demo done to ship the Lost Legacy, and it matched up with feelings that we were having, so we started discussing the responsibility of actually attempting this and started to feel that it was a little bit irresponsible, that if we were to try to meet both deadlines, we could probably do it, but we would end up doing a lesser job on both projects, both deadlines, than we would if we were doing it individually, and feels like they're both important enough to give them the due attention. So the conclusion that definitely is there is that the demo that was discussed yesterday will not be presented at E3.
Does it mean that our main point should be just focusing on more shipping before?
The Lost Legacy?
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely, but I mean, we should still try to... we don't, like I said, just want to just completely halt work on this and, you know, all hands on deck on Lost Legacy.
The idea is still to finish the demo just to give us a buffer so that these two deadlines aren't overlapping.
Okay.
It's just now we have more time to work on this demo properly without the pressure.
Once that meeting happened, it was just like, right, of course. I'm not in the Twilight Zone. It makes sense not to do this. It felt really nice seeing the leadership kind of having the team's back and seeing the logic of the situation in front of them.
That's it.
Cool.
Okay.
Thanks.
Okay, so are you pissed off?
Am I pissed off? No. What am I? I guess in one sense it's relieved because there was concern of whether we could hit the quality that we know we need to hit for both Lost Legacies and for our what was going to be our E3 demo. And then on the other end, it's kind of disappointed because I was excited to get this demo done and get it out there and get the reaction, but now it's going to have to happen at some other point.
What we've decided to do is deliver the demo at around the same time, but that's going to be purely internal and the demo won't be 100% shippable. Gameplay and design and animation are going to be locked in June. Then, like, we back off, we finish Lost Legacy, and then resources free up to finish the particle effects, the lighting, and the sound. And then we ship just the glossiest, best-looking demo you've ever seen. We burn that to a disc at the beginning of January, and then we don't touch it again, and nobody sees it until E3. It's going to be really interesting to see if we can really, really commit to being done, you know, 5 months, 6 months in advance of E3, and not be tempted to say, like, it could be a little better, let's go back. And we really just need to have the discipline not to do that.
But that then left us as like, okay, what's our next marketing beat? What are we gonna show next from this game?
So now we have a new plan where we're going to release a cinematic around PSX time. I think we're going to do it at the Paris Game Show.
This seemed like a pretty intriguing scene to introduce Abby. That whole scene is going to be our next marketing beat, and then we're not going to say much about it, about how this fits into the game, where it fits into the game.
Abby evolved over time, and if you look at the concept art, like, the character looked very different than where we've ended up. I don't remember at what point we decided to go with someone like really kind of muscular and broad, but I remember once the idea came up, it felt very fresh.
Once we sort of nailed down the body of Abby, we played around with different ideas of how we wanted to accentuate her arms or not.
And there's something interesting in Abby feeling a lot like Joel.
So when I got cast, Neil was like joking around. He's like, you should probably beef up in order to play her. And I'm like, ha ha, ha yeah, it's mocap, whatever. And he goes, no, really, you should probably beef up to play her. And I was like, oh, yeah, you're right. I should totally start deadlifting as much as possible. So I did, and I was training like crazy. And then I got pregnant. What are you gonna do?
We need to separate her from Ellie. It shouldn't feel like I'm playing a reskinned Ellie, that Abby should in many ways look, behave, fight differently. So in gameplay, we've discussed, well, she needs to have different upgrade trees. It means we have to make the investment of capturing a whole different moveset for Abby. We can't just remap Ellie's animation onto Abby.
Holy fuck.
Abby has a fear of height, and there's stuff we're doing with the camera to make you feel vertigo. And that helps build empathy. It makes this character real.
We let you both live, and you wasted it.
She's aesthetically a very intriguing and iconic and powerful character.
Abby, who are these kids? They saved my life. Can you take a look at her?
Once she's killed Joel, what is Abby's motivation? What is she trying to achieve? Her redemption is really taking care of Yara and Lev, these two kids that are from a warring faction.
You know, she has been taught to hate them. There is an inherent xenophobic reaction to them. It's about saying, can you come to love your enemy?
Scars built all this?
Seraphites.
Yeah, I was gonna say that.
These are kids that grew up in a very different context as Ellie, and, you know, how they live their lives and experience the world is totally different.
Now you're present. I'm getting really attached to Lev. He's been able to keep his head up despite losing so much himself in a world that is so harsh.
We're taking too long.
Can't move any faster. It won't do your sister any good if we're both dead.
I really like his dynamic with Abby. Her having this, like, fucking brassy little sidekick who calls her on her shit in a way that nobody else can.
What's going on between you and your friend Owen?
Oh my God, Lev, now?
It seemed really awkward.
Just go!
Who understands the sort of sense of being orphaned in the way that a lot of people can't.
How long have you two been on the run for?
2 days.
What the hell did you do?
I shaved my head.
They want to kill a little boy because he shaved his head.
I am not trans, so it's a very delicate thing to tell a story of an experience that I have not had. And that's something that we want to take seriously.
Did you hear what they called me?
Yeah.
Do you want to ask me about it?
Do you want me to ask you about it?
No.
Okay.
It's really about trying to create a multifaceted character who is trans, and that is absolutely an important part of who he is, but also a part of who he is, not the whole of who he is.
As far as the Paris cutscene, I'm pretty stressed out. We have 13 days, less than 2 weeks to finish this thing, and there are still some big ticket items. Lost Legacy turned out to be a much bigger project than we originally envisioned, but now that it's done, everyone is now on board.
We've got the Greenlight demo done.
She's putting on quite the show.
It's very real. We're in full production now, so I guess that's the short of it, is we're in full production now.
Hey everybody, PlayStation's live at Paris Games Week 2017. We've got a huge show for you starting now.
Wow, what a great way to open Paris Games Week.
let's have the first in-depth look at a much anticipated and exclusive title.
Last of Us 2. Last of Us 2. Please, please, please be Last of Us 2.
Our fans, they want to know every last thing about what's going to be in this game.
Is this The Last of Us?
Neil has taken the way, you know, he kind of creates an arc or like this sense of drama, this kind of sense of mystery or like dramatic tension, and crazily has brought it to marketing.
I view marketing as part of the game. It's very calculated what we put out there and how we want you to connect different marketing assets.
When we first released the teaser trailer, too many people right off the bat said Joel is dead.
The blown out light really, really fucked us in a way I don't think any of us saw coming.
We actually underestimated our audience a little bit. They're so sophisticated now, so you have to get more sophisticated, like how am I still gonna surprise players and viewers?
You start on characters you've never seen before in a world that like could be The Last of Us, could be anything. That creates like a really, really cool sense of tension.
At no point are we gonna market that you play as this other character.
What is this? God, it looks good though.
I was so excited about working on it and I couldn't say anything. It was so rough.
Oh, is she gonna cut a baby out of my belly?
And then trailer 4, you find a comic book that shows Ellie's mom pregnant. So people already had theories that Last of Us Part 2 was gonna have Ellie's mom. Oh, if we just kind of black out the letters, she has the same number of letters as Anna, Ellie's mom's name, we'll get people to think this is Ellie's mom.
Oh my God, girl's got a good... That hammer's from the Outbreak poster.
So we had that poster with the forearm of a character you've never seen before, with this like kind of wolf's head in the background. What does that mean? You know, kind of like prompting this mystery.
You want people to feel like they've figured everything out and then have the story surprise them.
Man, if this is The Last of Us 2, bro, I'm gonna go crazy.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
Last of Us 2?
Yes!
Yes!
Yes! Yes, bitch! Yes! I fucking knew it!
Everything that we put out there is shaping expectation. And then the final game, hopefully, if we do our job right, should subvert those expectations in an interesting way.
We knew we were pushing boundaries with that cinematic. We are making a violent game. We're not gonna shy away from how violent it is. It is part of what we're trying to say. And I thought it was a great discussion initially about what is the appropriate level of violence? When is something so violent that it just turns you off where you just don't wanna experience it at all? I liked that they were wrestling with those things. I didn't like some of the insinuations about the trailer being misogynistic towards the female characters.
I don't think this story ever glorifies violence against women. There's no bias towards women or men. It just so happens that the two protagonists of this story are female, and therefore that's what you're gonna see the most of. There has to be fail states in video games, which means a character has to be capable of being hurt. So does that mean that there can be no female protagonists in video games? Because that feels super sexist to me. And frankly, like, women are the victims of violence, and don't we want to see women fucking fight back once in a while?
That character, her hand getting hurt, it has consequences for hours of gameplay to come.
One article even like asked the question, were any women involved in the making of this? And it's like, yeah, the co-writer, the lead character designer, the lead character artist, all the actresses that worked on that scene.
I that's so fucking... Here's what I hate about that article. I'm sorry. Do a modicum of fucking research. Just a modicum of research. Just like a little bit before you put something out there to suggest that no woman could have worked on this because of the level of violence, because there was violence against women, because it is a video game.
is so fucking sexist. I like watching graphic violence. Does that make me less female? Like, I like having a conversation about what power is. Does that make me less fucking female? I like working at a video game. I like playing video games. Does that make me less fucking female? Like, suck a dick. Don't put that in. I can't. I can't. Neil's gonna say put it in, but don't. I also don't represent all women, but I represent, like, I can represent this and say, I fucking wrote this. I wrote this. Like, I literally wrote the sentence, and then Yara eviscerates his esophagus from his throat. I wrote that sentence. That is in the script, and I fucking stand by it. I'm afraid of being turned into a token rather than the truth, which is, like, we're being thoughtful about the female narrative. These characters are more than just their vaginas. If you want to have a serious debate about feminism and feminism in video games and female depiction of violence, and you need to not see it as a binary conversation. It is an incredibly nuanced conversation. You cannot make blanket statements, and you cannot make presumptions. Fucking do your homework. I'm right here. I'm tweeting.
The tone of the violence in the game has always been important to portray as realistically as possible.
Our job outside of just drawing up concepts is really pushing our reference pipeline to make sure that the character artists are getting the most realistic examples of whatever they're working on. We can't find certain things, so we make the reference ourselves.
Simulating brain on wall.
1, 2, 3.
How does that drip fall down?
What does canvas look like when it's soaked in blood?
Ooh.
Splashing blood on them, dripping blood on them.
Nice.
We put down some wet mud, pooled blood onto it to see how blood would react to a wet dirt surface.
So there's like little pieces of grass and like twigs and things that carry through, like there's actually movement.
Following the edge.
One of the animators got a piece of lamb and we stuck it in Yara's shirt sleeve and hit it with a hammer.
Here we go.
Yeah, we have a break.
She's gonna need to hold this as straight, because if she does this, it's gonna, you know, just the weight of it's gonna wanna make it fold. So I'm trying to keep it as straight as possible.
This past week's shoot was specific for the infected eating people's jugulars. And there was a concept that was done with like blood running down the mouth, but it, like, would that happen? Like, let's find out. I got on the ground and pretended to eat away at like a bloody soaked rag that we made. It produced some pretty surprising results because like most of my face got covered in blood.
Look up a little, John, but yeah, teeth. People here will go to that length of trying to make sure that things feel as real as possible. Yeah, we do a lot of crazy stuff here. Nobody gets hurt, but it's really hard to see these characters that you spend so much time with and, for lack of a better word, kind of like, you know, birthing into existence, tortured and abused.
We're shooting the Joel death scene, which is like the catalyst to opening of the game. This scene has all of Abby's crew. It's a complicated scene because it's the most actors we've ever had in a single shot.
Y'all act like you're hurting us or something.
It's because they have.
Or Joel doesn't die.
just me out.
Now that you got that.
Hold on. Sorry. Yeah. Minor line.
So
change.
Then, what happens is all of us become friends.
Yeah. Knowing what was going to happen and knowing how it was going to happen, I got very fearful.
There's so much weight to this scene. This scene has to be right. It's really difficult to reshoot it if we need to. But in the first game, having to call Troy and Hannah back to reshoot Sarah's death was very, very, very difficult for me.
The last time I tried to do a big emotional scene.
Don't do this, please, don't do this, don't do this, don't do this, don't do this, please, God, no. Oh, God, no.
That didn't go too well, and we had to reshoot it.
Don't do this to me, baby. Don't do this to me, baby. Come on.
How the hell am I going to play this? Like, how are we going to do this? I don't know if I can do this. I don't know if I have the chops. Am I going to put Laura through this? Because I know how hard it's going to be on her.
Audio.
Action.
Joel Miller.
Who are you?
Guess.
Why don't you just get out whatever speech you rehearsed? Get this over with.
You don't get to rush this.
At the end, I really loved what he brought to it.
I couldn't wait to get back into Ellie's shoes again because it's where, weirdly, I feel most comfortable in a lot of ways because it feels like a character that feels the most like me that I've ever played, which is a little disturbing. I mean, minus like the murder and the killing.
So it's almost like a bit of step forward, like you're about to like lunge and shoot. Yeah. Okay. Yes.
Sweet.
The biggest change that has happened since initial pitch is Ellie is there when Joel is killed. It used to be she came across the body and then she had to rely on Tommy's testimony of what happened. And we shifted it, which made it much more dramatic and intense for her. And I think puts more of it on screen and again, allows you better to understand why she needs to pursue these people.
The hardest part for me was looking over at Ashley.
No! No! Knowing that Troy was gonna not be a part of it as much was really hard. And knowing that Joel was not gonna be in Ellie's life anymore, it was hard. So much of that day kind of feels like a blur because there were so many feelings involved in it.
What I had to do, I felt, was very, very little. There's one reaction, and beyond that, we're on Ashley. There was no acting. There was pure, raw emotion. I'm staring in the face of that.
Joel! What are you doing this? Get the fuck off me! I'd lost a little bit of my voice. I couldn't scream like as loud as I wanted to, you know, to get that frustration and that sadness out.
Ashley was behind crying and God. And knowing Abby was taking this away from her was very difficult. And so I was crying when we were filming that scene. Yes, it was very emotional.
end it. Now.
Wait, please stop! No! No! Don't! Don't! No! No!
We want him to die in this really unforgiving sort of way. Like, it needs to feel senseless for you to say, fuck these people, I'm gonna pursue them to the ends of the earth and make them pay. If the scene doesn't work with what we captured on the stage, almost nothing we do in post is gonna make it work. Joe will take a pass at the scene. And I'll give kind of high-level notes.
But he's doing it without animated cameras, without character models, without environment. And so it's a bit of a guessing game to see if this will work.
So I like the concept. I felt like there was a lot of repetition and it felt long.
Once like Joel's head gets smashed, I don't want a close-up look of him.
Okay.
I wonder if we could do like the smash from the back of his head.
Yeah. I've wanted
so just like you, it'd be like a black shape, and you see like a silhouette change, and like blood starts pouring out. But I don't focus on it. Like I don't see the details.
Mm-hmm.
When the club comes down, and it's just like she's screaming, I feel like we could just take all their audio out, and like music could take over. And again, we're trying to build more rage than sadness. That's going to really set up our journey.
Okay.
I'll come back, and there'll be another version of the scene. Okay, play.
Joel, fucking get up. Please stop. Please open the door. Joel, stop. No. 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 No.
Overall, it's fucking awesome. Like, I got emotional on just the part where before he gets killed, it feels so fucking tense.
There certainly is still a ton to do. We still have, like, 45 scenes that haven't even been looked at yet. It's terrifying, given our deadline. The process right now is just getting Neil. We just need to get Neil into the room.
Which one are we showing first? We've got essentially three versions. The one that I did, and this would work with what we're talking about doing with the scene, and then...
Ah, close one.
I would probably say
there are people standing
this, yours, Mel, or
I got bad news
Mel, yours, this.
He's canceling?
He's canceled.
But we had the cameras set. This is, he's supposed to come in, he's the whole
actually, one. It's good we're getting this on camera.
This is what it's not about!
This is what it's about.
Yeah, he has some melee stuff to review today. He said, let's pick it up tomorrow.
So yeah, that's what happens. And so it's like, okay, all right, that's fine, I don't care. I don't care. Yeah.
I get called up to Neil's office one day. And there's like an empty seat. And Neil just goes like, oh, just sit down. I'm like, oh my God, I did something wrong. And he's like, do you know why you're here? And I'm like, no, are we gonna talk about one of my levels? And he laughs and he goes like, no, you're gonna work on the E3 demo. It's always been a dream of mine. Working on an E3 demo, seeing it on stage. Is this a joke? Like, am I getting pranked right now?
So speaking of E3 demos, remember way back when, like you guys said you were going to block that content and then not touch it? How's that go?
Well, and then we ship just the glossiest, best looking demo you've ever seen. We burn that to a disc at the beginning of January, and then we don't touch it again, and nobody sees it until E3.
Well, I think we knew at the time that we weren't going to not touch it. It's going to be really interesting to see if we can really, really commit to being done and not be tempted to say like, eh, it could be a little better, let's go back. Because the game's been making progress for, the 10 months or something since we locked that demo down.
lot of advances have been made, a lot of new ideas, new mechanics, and we really just need to have the discipline not to do that. Honestly, it feels like we are addicted to being late.
Okay, we're starting. I don't know exactly what we're gonna do today other than come up with a really long list. We're trying to limit it to an hour, so we'll be done at 4 no matter where we're at. Looking at the cinematics first.
Because we did it so early and had a rough version of it a year in advance, we got a bit complacent.
She's a, but not quite the show.
Sure is. Where are we on getting physics on these strands?
We are working on it.
So for next time? For next time?
Yes, yes, absolutely.
We didn't scramble to figure out what it is we're gonna show. We had the structure of like the festival going into this fight in the woods in Seattle, but it was harder to build the momentum we usually have. And I think that panic just wakes everybody up and felt like it took us a bit longer to get there this time.
So then you're going as if to kill this guy, see somebody over there.
Sir, over here.
Oh, breaks. Sorry. Breaks 50% of the time, but. Use your imagination.
Fuck.
Daniel, going a bit slower, give him some time.
Okay.
The animation is breaking the melee system.
Okay.
But like when he starts, yeah.
So okay. I'm confident in the demo if we finish it. I'll be frank, it's not looking great.
All right, this is totally broken. Let's, for next week, let's make sure it's all there so we could actually review it.
Yep.
Okay, thanks everyone.
I feel like this demo is cursed.
The E3 demo was a version of our original Greenlight demo. Scour! But I had to make it fully playable and shippable.
Viper!
The first thing I did was just basically take that space made by another level designer and put just enemies in it and start fighting. But when I started playing it, I remember like it wasn't there. That parking structure was way smaller, so it felt more cramped.
God is good.
God is good.
I remember going to Neil's office and being like, how much can I change this? And he's like, well, what are you thinking? I'm like, well, I'm thinking like this big thing. And I'm like, just like brand new designer. I'm just throwing out like everything. Like I want to do this and I want to do that. I want to make sure that feels like a sandbox, that it feels like this big space, that it's multiple paths. It's like something like we really haven't done before in The Last of Us. And he just goes, go for it. Well, let's do it.
We picked a location in Seattle that essentially is probably the hardest lighting scenario we would have to pull off in the game. I wanted to get the overcast look nailed because so much of the game's dependent on that. How do we pull off this look? Can we pull off this look?
Everything felt a little muted and we were losing kind of that next gen quality of our engine.
Like for a second, we actually turned the sun on in the demo.
But we lost the mood of that overcast kind of blue look.
That moment was really rough for me. Just felt like years of my life that potentially would have just been like wasted on this pipe dream of a look.
Well, we were struggling like last summer. It was like a fine balancing act.
Is this whole thing just gonna crumble? Like, is the whole direction like now gonna have to change for the game, not just this demo? Have I steered this company wrong?
Took some really big iterations and tried some crazy ideas, and we came up with kind of a hack.
We talked with the programmers and found a few settings that actually gave us exactly what we wanted. It was really like one thing.
We faked the sunlight within this kind of ambient look so we could get some directionality of the lighting.
But it was like, oh, if we do this one thing, it actually got us the look we wanted. So like, I'm glad that happened.
For this game, there was a major push to make a new volumetric fog system. It's not just like a kind of an overlay on top of the screen. That's why it's called volumetric. You feel the volume of it. It's gonna be a little bit thicker near the ground, right? Because there, you know, and you will see grass kind of getting through it. Fog also allows you to see the light. Fog adds atmosphere. Atmosphere brings everything together. Now with this game, we did add recently some new tech that allows us to make some of the water drips more dynamic, meaning that if you have a car, you will see a water, follow the glass, follow the hood, and then from the bumper, you're gonna start seeing dynamic droplets. So that was really cool. And then we can now actually also use this technology to drive blood. Now we can have blood dripping and we have water dripping. The water trail can pick up where is it bloody. And if it's bloody, it can change its own color and start dripping more red. And on top of it, we also clear out the blood. So what you will see is you will see bloody area, you will see water trails going down, and you will see the water trails washing out the blood and picking up the redness and going down. Really, really cool.
In the E3 demo, we do want to show our next-gen animation system.
One of the biggest animation upgrades we wanted to add to this project was motion matching. The way that it works is it takes a pool of animation data and it picks the most appropriate clip to blend together and create just very fluid and organic movement. We want these characters to just feel grounded and believable in the world, properly shifting their weight and moving the way a real human would. In order to capture all of those on the stage, we use something called a dance card, a choreographed set of patterns that the actor can move on the floor.
Basically, that's creating this like bank of little pieces of animation. The motion matching system just pulls from that bank all the animations necessary to have them move perfectly in any arbitrary way. When it works, it's like so far and away better than any other animation technique. It's like a quantum leap of the highest order in terms of quality.
Any one mechanic is not maybe anything you haven't seen before. It's the combination of how it all comes together, the way it works with the animation system.
The new stuff we're talking about is like, oh, you can be in grass.
She went into the grass. Watch yourself.
Like one of the biggest things we do in the demo is jump a gap. It's tough to be like, oh crap, you can jump, you know, like it's like, but it's new to our game.
We have to have the best prone mechanic of all time. Yeah, no one's ever seen when I aim in prone and she actually like rolls up on her back and aims like this. Like it can never clip through geometry. Being able to rotate 360 in all directions, it can never like do a janky thing when she's reloading while doing it or aiming. In water, there's like an IK thing that like lift her chest and head up, and then it gets too deep. Now we're in a special prone underwater moveset thing. Her chest and arms and everything are kind of matching ground plane. Things that a player will never notice. And it's because we like purposely did it. There's no such thing as like, oh, you know, it's not as good as, you know, this other game's one, but like, it's fine. It's gotta be like, no, it's fucking Naughty Dog. We have to have the best version of the thing, whatever that is.
E3 overall was amazing. The press conference was in a very different venue. They usually have them in like these big auditoriums. And this was kind of like, almost like a pop-up.
More like a theme park idea, but it's like in a parking lot, in a tent, in Los Angeles, at downtown. They built the whole crazy church thing, which was pretty rad.
It was super cool. It was better than we expected.
and you could feel like the tension of people trying to figure out, what is this press conference? What's going on? What game are they going to show here? On the Naughty Dog logo, you get this big cheer. On the Ellie reveal, you get this big cheer. Every moment that we've constructed and planned, like, meticulously for really a year now, hit, and hit the way we wanted it to hit.
Maybe they're jealous of you. I'm just a girl, not a threat. I think they should be terrified of you.
One of the biggest reactions was when the HUD came on.
Shit.
They looked at that forest and thought, there's no way it can look this good. Like, that's impossible. But when we flash the HUD and be like, yeah, that's it. This is the real game. People are not ready for this. Like, this is gonna fuck you up. Electric. My skin was like tingling the whole time.
Like, as soon as it's done playing, I'm like on my phone.
And it was wild. It was wild to see it just everywhere. See it on YouTube, see people commenting on it. It was a really special moment. I shipped something, like, as a level designer.
There was such a reaction to the animation fidelity. Holy crap, this is the best looking animation I've ever seen. Are you kidding me?
We're on the forums going through the messages, seeing how much people think it's amazing. Someone's like, sort of cynically, that our stuff was fake.
I guess it's kind of a compliment to the animation team for, like, someone to say it's fake when they're working so hard. And right away I responded, I was like, don't respond, don't do anything. Like, it's just not professional.
I was also a little anxious about it because it's a little fake, you know?
Fake is an interesting word. There's an argument that he's right.
It's not the final polished game. You can't just play this demo in any way. You have to play it in this very specific way. But before we even show the demo, it's like, let's not put anything in there we feel like we can't do.
There was no thing of like, we don't know how we're gonna do that. It was just, we literally just don't have it systemic yet. You know, like, systemically, a guy pulling you out from underneath a car, we didn't have that hooked up yet.
Motherfucker!
Now we have it hooked up in the game.
It's her! Arthur! All over soon!
Ultimately, as we're building the rest of the game, if anything feels like it's not the right call for the game, we don't mind changing it. Like, we had certain things in the demo for the first Last of Us where, like, Joel picks up a pistol and takes out individual bullets from it and then pockets it. And, like, we could have done that, it just took too long. So for gameplay purposes, we cut that out.
I was talking to other animators and they were like, yeah, man, they think it's fake. They have no idea, like, it's awesome.
The same animators who made this demo are gonna make the final game, so, like, I don't know what you're talking about.
They were confident, which I'm glad.
We knew what what we were doing and we knew how special it was. It was a little bit of a microphone drop to the industry. And for many, it was inspirational, and they were excited to be able to add some of those details to their games and their future games. And for some of them, it absolutely freaked them out to see this might be the new bar that's expected for other games to follow.
Part of me is like, oh shit, like, they're fucking calling us out. It's like, we have to deliver this. Like, we always were gonna, but now it's like, people have called us out, so we have to do a full body throw animation when you pick up a bottle and you're running, and not just a partial animation, because that guy fucking called us out.
The real challenge is making the whole game look as good as this one control situation.
We come out of E3 and hopefully we've set the standard for this, what the rest of the game needs to feel like.
When you already know exactly what you're supposed to do in the game, you've memorized everything, it's hard to have a true experience with it. You have to bring in people from the outside to play it fresh.
And so we try to start playtesting as early as possible. We've got testers in bright and early. They're going to start playing the game. They're actually just right across the hall over here.
It is a fire drill. Because things have to work.
So I'm currently watching the 10 people that we have in at the moment focus testing. We've got all of their screens up, so I can kind of watch all of them at the same time, generally keep track of any kind of recurring patterns or how long people generally take in certain areas.
They do things we haven't thought of, and it really shows us where our holes are. It's like, maybe I should change this. Maybe I should try that.
This player's pretty lost, trying to figure out this puzzle here, and they're trying to jump on a truck. He's got a really awesome solution here where he's putting this plank on a dumpster, and now he's moving the dumpster around. So we'll probably have to go in there and like try and fix some of that stuff up, but we'd rather figure that out now than in 6 months.
For things like puzzles like this one, that although they're figuring out the puzzle, they're actually not doing it in the kind of order that I'd like. What would be better is if they came into the space and realized, okay, that's the thing I need to be like climbing up to or getting to, and then they can kind of work backwards from there and go, well, if I need to get there, how do I get up? Oh, I can get up on this thing. It's quite heartbreaking when you see people who are like really confused or don't get it, and it's something you think like it should be obvious, but it's not at all. But it's good data.
We've had a few people on the team that have been really passionate about making our games even more accessible for people with different kinds of disabilities and making sure as many people as possible can experience our game.
Accessibility is something that like really touches a lot of people. As we get older, pretty much all of us are going to have probably some sort of accessibility need.
It's important to welcome people with disabilities into all of our public spaces, into our shared culture, and that video games are a rich part of that.
I love this, that you don't have to have like a two-button feature to keep her crouched down. Mm-hmm. This is awesome. I love that.
Nice. Brandon Cole, he said, I heard you announce this game. What do you think about the possibility of someone like myself being able to play it? And Brandon is blind. I hadn't really thought about that before. I don't even know if that's even possible, but I want to try because that sounds interesting.
If you click on the L3 button, it turns the screen and the character towards your next objective. So you're able to sort of instantly sort of flip.
I was very much inspired by the talk you gave last time you were here.
I figured.
Hopefully that's
a beautiful thing.
We had this feature that let you navigate along the golden path. And we also had this other feature. You could like put out this sonar pulse and you'd hear where all the items and enemies were located. But Brandon was playing that and was like, this navigation feature is great, but I don't want to just follow the golden path. I want to navigate to other things. It kind of occurred to us like, oh, we can combine these two features. We can let you scan for items and then navigate to that item.
This gives you more room if you do it this way for different types of sounds for different types of items, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
different
awesome.
Sound for ammo, different sound for parts, different sound for explosive, different sound for keys. Or
craftable, yes. And collectible.
Yes, yes, exactly.
Right on.
But since we want to hunt for secrets, just like anyone else, you're also going to be able to want to know that, hey, there's something way over there.
Players with disabilities still want to have challenge.
It's not about just making an easy mode.
Mm-hmm.
So what happened there was an auto Ooh. Vault. So Ooh. You pressed into a wall and it automatically vaulted.
I feel happy about this.
This is an example of actually the good part of the studio culture, which is self-empowered, that I think allowed us to do this crazy thing, this thing that, you know, I couldn't tell you if it makes business sense to some degree, but it was something we were passionate about and interested in. It was a way we saw we could make the game better. It was something we saw we could like push the frontiers of, and we went with it. Studio leadership was supportive of us, but this really was like a bottom-up kind of initiative.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that early success really helped to build momentum for the rest of the project.
Shielding everybody from the cost, from the budget of these decisions helps them focus on their discipline. Don't worry about money, worry about making the best game possible. Trust that there are people at the top that are looking at the budget and considering that.
At a certain point in the project, we start offering dinners to the team. And it's kind of like an acknowledgement of like, okay, there's a lot of hard work to get done. We know people are probably going to want to be staying late. Now we are crunching. This is crunch.
I must have felt it for months that this release date is not realistic with how big the game is. People were asking us, is this a real date? Because it's not feeling like a real date anymore. So we felt like we had to react pretty soon. And then at some point, it just felt like because people were starting to put in longer hours, it wouldn't have been fair to not figure this stuff out sooner than later.
Finish this game.
If you work hard for longer, that could have a toll on you. We tell everybody, pace yourselves. It's like it's a marathon, it's not a sprint. We settled on a February release date. Leave some gas in the tank.
Right now, we are dancing a very intricate and dangerous dance. We have something like 6 months left to finish the game. And we are also showing a demo to the press. The longest playable demo we've ever done. Two separate levels of the game. A level towards the beginning of the game where you play with Dina on patrol outside of Jackson. And then the second part of the demo is in a level super duper challenging.
Ellie by herself, murder mode.
So what we're doing for the press in 9 weeks is really those two levels of the game. It's unlikely that we're going to need to touch them again until the game ships. That was really the only kind of demo that we could do at this point that would still help further our production goals as well as give us this like marketing boost that we need.
The more we talk about it, the more we convince ourselves, okay, this would actually be a good time to just put out a trailer.
Building these two major demos and a trailer next to the rest of the fucking game.
And it felt impossible early on. I mean, it's the thing that's always hard for us, the polish. You review these things and we're looking at all these tiny details. It's like, Even that shot of Jackson is like, where should the trees be? How much fog should it be? How much sun should it be? How should the sun hit the clouds? How we get all these civilians, the kids, do they have the proper gear? Are they wearing the right clothes? Is the tractor leaving tracks on the ground? That kind of crazy detail could only come through all these departments coming together and rising this occasion to achieve that kind of level of quality. We wanted to show the team the final trailer.
Before we show you the trailer, just to say thank you to everyone, where we jumped from doing a 3-hour demo to this trailer where we had almost nothing, and it's like a pretty amazing what we can do when we all come together. In fact, it's so amazing you can forget, and I've been here for a long time and I can forget. So to remind you, and maybe reignite some of that panic, we're gonna show you two trailers, one from exactly a month ago, and one from about an hour ago when we wrapped up the trailer. So enjoy.
Yes. Look who decided to join us. All right, you all know the drill.
Dino, where are you?
You think I'd let you do this on your own?
Feels alive.
Don't like it's one clap.
Keep in mind, this is what the whole game's gonna look like. We're gonna make it this awesome.
You can't stop this.
This was a good reminder. Look, when we come together, when we rise to the occasion, when we do this thing that people outside the studio talk about, like this Naughty Dog magic, this is what it looks like. So when you look at parts of the game that aren't there yet, know that we could get there in a pretty short period of time when we're so focused.
Date was the scariest part of the
whole. We got the trailer done. We'll talk to you. Just wanted to take this moment to run through the events of Outbreak Week, which is when the trailer is going to debut. We are going to be having the big press event in Koreatown at this giant warehouse. We actually having 80 journalists from all over the world come. We got made sure very comfortable chairs for 3 hours.
Outbreak Day is the day the outbreak happened in the United States in 2013.
In real life, we celebrate September 26th as Last of Us Day.
Every September 26th, we've done something for Last of Us fans.
When people play these two sections, which are very different, I hope and I feel that both of them are equally impressive. When you play that first demo, you're like, that was incredible.
Oh my God.
This could have been the whole demo. This could have been the whole thing. It says enough about what the game is. And then you play the other half, and it's like way more mechanics heavy, way more combat heavy.
Keep going, boy. There.
In the highest level of how Naughty Dog is perceived as a company, it's that we're story first and mechanics second. A lot of it is, I think, proving to the press and proving to people that, yes, we can do both.
I want people to walk around and say, this is the best controlling, this is the best feeling third-person shooter.
It's on the level of the best action stealth games you've ever played.
Just shut up.
So one of the things that I've always found really exciting about The Last of Us is the kind of fidelity with which we represent human intelligence.
One of the ways that really helped make them feel more human and more alive was the way that they use their body language to communicate to each other.
Everybody spread out. We may have multiples.
We had a number of sessions where the animation team, design team, and programmers all got together and we acted out a number of scenarios. And what that does is it gives us really great reference and touch points that we can always look back to about the way that we naturally behave, the way we naturally respond to each other. And those are the types of details that we want to weave back into the game.
Someone took out Zoe! Who the fuck's out there? Sweep the whole goddamn street.
Our NPCs are named so that you understand these people have relationships.
They want to get revenge on you. It's this little mini loop of the whole premise of the game.
Omar! Flanker!
I just killed their friend and they want to kill me now.
Omar!
There's a cost. You killed that person. His friend now feels a loss. You know, his dog is now alone.
Dogs are really difficult to start off with because they're quadrupeds. They just don't turn around. They kind of like wheel around a little bit.
Smell something, girl?
The main concern we had is how is it that we can actually get a dog to perform a dance card on the motion capture set? And when we finally brought them on set, it was just incredible what these dogs were capable of doing and what the trainers were able to accomplish in a short time.
Jump, 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 jump!
Good boy, there you go.
They move extremely quickly, so they're super hard to shoot.
Right in here! Fuck!
They are very low to the ground. You have like these attacks that are designed to go up here, and now you have to kind of do them down there.
Killing a dog has gotten people more like upset than anything else in the game, than hanging people, than eviscerating people.
We're gonna break new ground in dog murder.
We had like a new scripter start like 2 months ago. First question, she walks into the middle of the room. I have one question. Does the dog survive? And everyone's like, oh no, first day, first day, first day, first day.
So we killed it, and then you have to love it knowing that it's already dead. So there's gonna probably be people that are upset about that.
Hey, Al, you wanna go to the trucks? Let's go to the trucks.
With the notable exception of Alice, we took great pains to ensure that every combat encounter that you fight against a dog, you do not have to kill any of them. It's more palatable to kill people because they're all there because they choose to be there, but all of these dogs were trained to do this exact thing, and so you're killing an innocent creature.
What's that? Fuck! Fuck!
Got you.
That feeling of discomfort, it's exactly what we're trying to explore with The Last of Us. Ironically, making them more realistic makes people feel more okay about killing them. We had, like, kind of a goofy art prototype. We had, like, just a very rough dog. We found that goofy dog that had no fur, people felt really bad about killing that dog. Like when you would shoot them, they would fall over dead and like give one last whine as their like dying breath and stuff. So we just really tried to like tone down the pitiability of all the dogs and stuff.
The best sound in most games are the stuff you don't notice. The Foley in the game is extremely detailed. Things like Foley are very easy to get wrong and noticed for the wrong reason, very difficult to get right, but when you get it right, no one's gonna pat you on the back for it. Couple of cool notes. Audio guys are kind of a different breed. We listen to everything all the time. It's kind of a curse. Our ability to use pre-recorded assets from a library that's like commercially available has been diminished almost entirely because we have very specific needs.
Do one more of those.
We're trying to take what we did in the first game and bring it to another level of detail.
Is
Yeah, play with that a little bit. Huh? Like, mixing that tonality in is cool. Yeah, yeah.
The enemies themselves, especially the infected, have had to go through a review process. In the first game, they're pretty coarse. They're basically like on or off. They're either walking around mumbling, or they're freaking out trying to get you. And so now we've developed sort of this like murmuration breath system that allows them to have a much more natural flow between being agitated and not. A big part of those recording sessions is working with the voice actors. It's much more collaborative.
Yeah, that's cool. I kind of want to see what your more natural voice sounds like.
You're basically trying to coach people that they're not zombies.
Yeah, now imagine sprinting.
Ready, out of breath.
No,
that's cool, dude.
Yeah, take your time, man.
That's great. Really great.
One of the folks that we worked with, the sounds he was able to generate from himself was unlike anything I've ever heard before. Gnarly sounding roars and breaths and wheezes and really interesting stuff that I've never heard come out of a person ever. Sound is, we're inherently post-production on a lot of this stuff. We kind of just have to be jamming and we have to be as prepared as possible, and that's what we try to do. A lot of stuff is yet to come for us, which means there's not a lot of time left. Which means that it's gonna get really intense. It gets really intense for everybody, but for audio in particular, we'll be here late.
I think that, I don't know if it's the whole studio, but I know I'm definitely feeling very tired right now. I'm feeling a little burned out. I'm realizing that I can't crunch like I used to. I can't put everything I have into these games as much as I was able to when I first got here. It's pretty unanimous that this game is really big, where it's bigger than we'd like it to be.
The Last of Us Part One is small compared to this game. My argument, make the game small again. I don't even call them small.
There were times when I was writing like 40 pages of in-game dialogue a night. Neil kept saying, stop, you have to like give it to somebody else. We will hire somebody, we will make this work. And I was like, I think it'll just be, I was just bullishly like, we're gonna handle it, I'm tough. I would like somebody to teach me how to have work-life balance.
There are some times where I wish I had somebody in production or a big brother that could be like, no, go home, this is great. This is already great. You don't need to do the next thing.
I feel like at any given point, you'll go into the kitchen and you'll find people, what I would say, salonning about the game, like going deep philosophy into what's working, what isn't. People criticizing this or that. This doesn't look good. I don't like this scene. This doesn't work for me. I hate this.
You know, like they're going to lunch and like expressing doubt to each other and like, is this gonna come together? Is this the one that like screws Naughty Dog up? Let me just exude whatever confidence I have left. Let me try to bestow this person with it so they can feel inspired and go off and do their work. But then sometimes you're alone in the office and you're like, what if this doesn't come together? What if this is the one that sucks? What if this is the one that sinks Naughty Dog? So then you have to like kind of bury it, compartmentalize it. Who knows what damage it does to your body while you're doing that? Because ultimately, you can't let that fear dictate how you work and just keep the faith.
The game was just about done. Was content complete? We were fixing bugs when...
There's these, like, rumblings of this pandemic happening.
Like, I remember when this COVID hit and we're like, bro, really? Like, for real pandemic?
You know, at first it feels like, oh, this is nothing we need to worry about. And then all of a sudden you do have to worry about it.
And like, are people gonna wanna play a game that takes place in a pandemic when there's a real pandemic?
We had never worked from home ever. Naughty Dog was actually strictly against working from home.
We did not have the infrastructure set up at this studio to work from home.
And it's because we were so intense about security and leaks that all of our data, including our emails and our chats and IMs, it all had to be on a server inside the building. We were like air-gapped from the outside world.
The operations team, the IT team, our engineering team, they all had to coordinate in a very short period of time to get us working from home. We don't even know when the game can come out.
Sony was like, we don't know if we can physically ship this product with like the supply chain and stuff.
We had to come out and say, the game can't come out on this date, and we don't even know when it will come out. It's delayed indefinitely. So a lot of our most hardcore fans are angry with us. Around the same exact time, we started having these leaks. We're like, we didn't put out this video. Like, where is this coming from? It's a video from one of our reviews. So you could hear the notes, and people that can't attend the meeting can watch it after the fact. We store all these videos on our server. Did it come from the inside? Someone within Naughty Dog?
My first thought was, this isn't like a developer leaking this, isn't it? This isn't someone on the team.
It's this person in the Netherlands downloaded terabytes of videos through a back door in the server. And then this is where we made a fatal error. Let's close this back door. And then this person put out everything. A video goes up on YouTube, and I don't remember what the first video was, but it was something relatively benign.
But they weren't like super important scenes. You know, they were like little clips, and it was like, okay, that's a little weird. What is that?
All out of order and stuff. And I was like, oh, that's bad.
And you kind of wanted to just say, stop, wait, don't watch it. Like, you're gonna ruin things for yourself.
There's YouTubers I've watched for years, and they're making entire videos, and the title is like, fuck Naughty Dog. And fuck The Last of Us Part Two.
There's just all this negativity and no positivity because no one has played the game. They just have these videos out of context and all these rumors mixed with them. Abby is playable.
They thought Abby was trans because she has muscles.
Here's the ending if they kill Ellie.
And then it just turns into this whole political thing. Oh, Naughty Dog's all they're doing this political shit.
And then I get this text from Evan. They just posted Joel's death. And my heart sinks. I can't even describe this feeling. It's just this like dread. It's almost like you just heard someone you care about died. I don't know, that's the closest I could come to. I thought Troy would be looking at that and be like, you see, you were wrong.
He said, do you think we did the right thing? And I said, I don't know, Neil. I haven't played the game yet. I was livid. I was real angry.
I'm bombarded with hundreds of negative comments, death threats, anti-Semitic comments. It's putting me in a deep depression.
There's some stupid stuff that's like, you're a feminazi, you're whatever shit like that. But it's like some stuff was really like, you know, disturbing.
The hatred, I think, that was behind it. I was sad. Like, there were a lot of days where I would just cry.
Every time I went online, it was just, that's all I saw was death threats and threats of violence. And the worst of it, the really, like, hardcore death threats got passed along. And they, you know, made sure that they weren't anyone that, like, lived close by. Yeah, they were, like, threatening my son, you know, who was born during all of it. And, yeah, it was rough. It was rough. But, you know, more than anything, it kind of taught me to kind of keep a distance, you know?
this thing that I spent 4.5 years on, it's kind of getting violated.
And then for 2 months before release, there's like nothing you can do. You can't release the game sooner because it's not done yet.
And that was the lowest point in my life. I'm working on the game towards the end at home by myself, feeling very alone. And I said, who am I doing this for? Like, why am I, why, this is, it's too much. And I barely squeaked by. And then we were able to finish it. And, you know, we sent it to reviewers and reviews are through the roof. Called Troy and I said, like, dude, I'm sorry. I feel like I failed you. And he's like, what are you talking about? And I'm like, yeah, I just know how some people talk. He's like, oh, dude, I don't care. I played the game and I love it. And I got really emotional. It's like, I realized how much I care about Troy caring about the game. And that was a huge sense of relief.
There's not a single aspect of the game, part two, that I would change. And anytime someone comes up to me and says, you know, I didn't really like what they did to Joel. I was like, great, awesome. Tell me a better version of the story. And to this day, they still can't.
It was a traumatic experience for myself and many people on the team. And the kind of hate we got because of those leaks will stay with me forever. And I can't even describe how angry I was of what the damage this person did to us. I want them punished in every sort of way. I wanted this to be this really, this villain. And this person is like, you know, in their 20s or whatever. They live with their parents. And it's a fan. And then when we delayed the game indefinitely, this is what they said, is like, I wanted to force Naughty Dog's hand. I wanted to force them to release the game. So I thought if I just put out all the videos, eventually they'll put out the game, which again was never an option for us. And I remember sitting there, sitting in my anger, and then going like slowing down and just saying, okay, if anybody should take the lesson from Last of Us Part Two, it should probably be us. Just let it go. Eddie Vedder to play Future Days for the Game Awards. I'm a huge Pearl Jam fan.
Really?
Yeah, I know. So shocking to many people.
What a fascinating way to tell a story. It's just getting better and better all the time. And I really appreciate the way that Future Days was used, especially bringing Joel and Ellie together, connecting through music. It was cool to be part of it. So thanks for having me. And enjoy the rest of the show.
How lucky am I? Like, how cool is this? This person that I've admired since I was a kid is now, like, mentioning this game that we all made. And then we started winning award after award after award. I wanted that validation for the team.
Everyone at Naughty Dog, I can't wait to hug and high-five and get drunk with each one of you. That's going to have to wait till next year. And more than anything, and I know that I speak for the whole team when I say this, we'd like to thank our friends and family that stood by us and supported us throughout us making this game. You inspire us not only to make better, more meaningful games, but to improve how we make games.
The pandemic kind of brought up that question of like health and mental health. Are we developers that are gonna stay at the studio and have full careers. How do we make this sustainable?
I chuckle in retrospect just how absurd the failure of trying to alleviate crunch was. If you have great processes and you're super organized, that doesn't fix crunch. What that does is it allows you to make a bigger game.
We read the postmortem feedback for The Last of Us 2, and it was really, really upsetting to see what coworkers had gone through. So we were highly motivated to try to figure out how to fix it.
Everything about our workflows were already being upended with remote work and everything. So it's like, okay, well, yeah, we got to do this now.
And we knew that to make the real changes we did, it would take the entire studio working together.
We now have the goal for Naughty Dog to eliminate crunch.
The only thing that fixes crunch, the only thing, is just deciding that you're not going to crunch.
When we onboard people, we tell them, you know, we have a reputation as a studio for crunching, and it's something we don't want. And it's something we're not going to do anymore.
First, we had to do, what is crunch? Let's define it. Because when you just look at hours, that turned out to be too simplistic.
It's a multitude of factors. It's not just like one thing. It's not just, oh, because of this, this is what's causing crunch. It's literally like so many of these little things.
How do we make sure no one at Naughty Dog burns out?
You know, every couple of months, we send out a 90-second questionnaire that goes, are you worried about your workload? Are you worried about having to work overtime? If you feel like I'm overburdened with work, you have to tell somebody. We used to, as a studio, when we were getting close to shipping a game, bring in dinners for the whole studio. We don't do crunch dinners anymore.
Being able to work from home is hugely helpful for me, from my mental health, of like, you know, my daughter's there, my wife is there.
Hybrid is really the sweet spot because I think the benefits have just been enormous.
In the past, our leads, our managers, were the people that were best at their craft, but not necessarily the best managers.
So we created the role of principal.
We really gave people the choice, like, do you want to make stuff or do you want to lead and manage?
And Arnaldo is now a lead designer here.
Now I'm responsible for a team, and I really enjoy that. And being able to share that knowledge and kind of work with someone, even if they're more experienced than me, and it's been great so far.
We have a very large and robust production department now that we didn't have.
Holding us accountable when we make a decision, when it's just everyone going, yes, more, yes, better, yes, polish, 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 tallying that up and going, okay, well, this is the result. Now you're not in your ship date anymore.
It feels so much like a different studio.
I hope that we can keep changing for the better and make sure that we're making the games that we want to make, that we're really passionate about, that we don't stop doing that.
We want self-driven, healthy designers.
Yes,
we
exactly.
Want to have it all. We want to have it both. And can we do that? That'll be the question, I guess.
The HBO's thing has been a wild ride.
I just wanted it to be, like, good. Like, dude, if it just comes out and it's a good show, like, that's gonna be huge.
I'm sure it will be very different when I actually see Abby being portrayed. That will be so weird. I can't imagine what Ashley and Troy must be feeling.
Specifically because Ellie is a part of my heart. In some ways, it was really hard. I feel like Bella was the only person who could play her because I feel like she is Ellie. There's a part of me that's like weirdly protective of her.
I remember when Neil told me, like, we found Joel. I was like, he wasn't missing. he goes, Pedro Pascal. And I went, oh, we're bulletproof.
It felt like Craig and Neil together saw that this was a story about humanity, and they made it a story about humanity.
We got Frank. Who knew that was waiting? Craig's screaming from the sidelines going, I did.
When Neil and Craig asked me to play Ellie's mother, Anna, it made me so happy. And I'm crying, so it doesn't seem like it, but it was symbolic in so many ways to me. Being able to sort of bring Ellie into the world, be the first one to fight for her. It breaks my heart.
It felt like on the other side, we could get this story to people that will never play a video game.
My mom is watching the show, and like, she can enjoy this story, and she can be a part of it. And she's so excited and working on season two and getting to see that.
I love this idea that someone could watch the show and then realize, wait, that's based on a video game? And come back and check out the game and then realize, oh, there's like all these rich games, AAA, indie, and all sorts of stories that are really unique to this medium. I did some other interview where someone asked me about The Last of Us and would there be any more stories or something. And I mentioned, like, you know, we have written a story that takes place after Last of Us 2 that stars Tommy. And I hope one day we get to make it. And the headlines across the industry were like, Naughty Dog has outlined Last of Us Part 3. And that's actually wrong. It was always a small story. It was never like a full title. At the time, we had higher priorities than Naughty Dog. Was like to fix our pipeline, to fix work-life balance issues. Just based on where we were, I didn't want to prioritize this story, so that story was shelved. And I still believe one day it will see the light of day. I don't know if it'll be a game or a show, TBD. First game had such a clean concept of like the unconditional love a parent feels for their child. The second one, once we landed on this idea of the pursuit of justice at any cost, justice for the ones you love, it felt like, oh, there's a clean concept here, and there's a through line from the first game about love. If we never get to do it again, this is a fine ending point. And right, last bite of the apple, the story's done. The great thing about working at Naughty Dog is that we don't have to. It's always like, we would love another Last of Us, but if you guys feel like we're passionate about something else, we'll support this other thing. Very privileged position to be in. I never take that for granted. I've been just thinking about, okay, is there a concept there? And for now years, I haven't been able to find that concept. But recently that's changed. And I don't have a story, but I do have that concept that to me is as exciting as one, as exciting as two, is its own thing and yet has this through line for all three. So it does feel like there's probably one more chapter to the story.